sustainable development. By that, I'm talking about growth mainly, so economic development. And I'm going to use the OECS as a sort of framework in which I'm going to talk about it. Right? But I'm certain that some of the lessons are applicable throughout. All right, so the OECS growth rates have been falling since in the 90s. GDP per capita has been growing at about an average of 1.7% per annum. And when you compare that to Latin America, for example, where the growth rate is about 2.3%. Public sector debt has been mounting, and there's a struggle to consolidate gains that, you know, developmental gains that would have been achieved in the 80s. So what I'm seeking to do in this presentation is to seek to understand what has been the motivation or reason behind points 1 and 2, and offer the makings of an approach that could secure or expand the developmental gains that we have referenced previously. And in that context, I talk a bit about health as one of the approaches. Before doing an inquiry, it's always advisable to sort of set it in a particular theoretic framework. So confronted about three choices that I recognize that I probably could use to begin to analyze the question of growth in and sustainable growth within the OECS. I could use a standard orthodox approach with the standard neoclassical assumptions. Another approach probably is to use the plantation economist school of thought, the likes of Best, Levitt, Govan, and so on. And I mean, they place a lot of emphasis on the importance of historical and institutional context as a means of explaining development and explaining growth. Or I could use Dimas, who is my preferred candidate in this regard, because I particularly find his model to be the model that he proposed to be parsimonious in that it is simple and it explains a lot. And in his main thesis is that size is an important circumscribing parameter in explaining growth in Caribbean economies. and in Dimas, and for the students, we're all students, I guess, but for those who are relatively young in their journey through economics, I mean, the work of Dimas, in particular his book on the economic development in small countries, it's worth a read. It's just about 100 or something pages. Please read it. Smallness poses some specific challenge to sustain growth. Because of necessity, small economies are open. They're likely to be enclaved economies dependent on a very few exports for growth. And they tend to, because of small domestic market, there's limited possibility for competition. And these all violate very critical and often unstated assumptions in the standard model. And in Dimas's work, he uses a specific definition for development, which I think is very useful. Development, he says, is related to structural transformation and the economy's capacity to adapt and apply innovation. And he provided about 7 indicators of structural transformation. I just highlight a few. Reduction in dualism in sectoral productivity, reduce unemployment, reduce imports as a share of GDP, and that the underlying socio-political institution changed to to allow for economic adaptability. All right. At a very simplistic level, growth can be derived from basically three sources. Growth in final consumption, and by final consumption, I'm including private sector and government consumption. Growth in capital formation, and growth in net export. In small economies, the green buttons are good. The red one can be a bit of a challenge, and we'll explain why. And the important thing to note is that because of the openness of the economy, any good that derives from final consumption is going to be susceptible to a high level of leakages, right, which sort of curtail the eventual multiplier effect that it could have on the economy as a whole. So this is what has been happening in a broad view in the OECS economies for the past quarter of a century. And as you could see, FCON, which is final consumption, that is solid, very solid unbroken line. That has been growing at a faster rate relative to all the other components of GDP. All right? And you see that your net imports, which is the reverse of net exports, have been increasing, which is a bad thing. All right? And I put a comparative to Latin America just to amplify the point. Now, it's important to note that the growth in consumption is largely unrelated to developments in other components of GDP. So in this chart, we see, again, what I've done is I've divided or broken out consumption expenditure into a portion that is induced by capital formation, a portion that is induced by exports, and a portion that is autonomous, is not driven by any of these. And the solid line is the autonomous portion, and you can see that is what has been driving the whole of consumption in the OECS. And what has been the quality of this growth? Economic concentration still persists. Yes, we see that agriculture as a share of GDP has been declining, right? But we still, the economy is still concentrated. It has shifted from agriculture to tourism. This is a chart showing tourism's contribution to total GDP. And in some countries like Antigua, it's nearly 60%. In St. Lucia, it is 40% of GDP and 45% of jobs. So highly concentrated as per usual. This growth has had a questionable impact on the unemployment rate. Despite the so-called growth of 1.7% or something like that, the trend seems to suggest that your unemployment rate is rising. I mean, this is just based on available data from St. Lucia. Unfortunately, in the other countries, there isn't a time series on unemployment rate. All right, so this has sort of led to a crisis in the OECS growth model. The consumption-driven growth was policy-led. I mean, if you look at, I've just aggregated the autonomous consumption by across the OECS, and you see that clear spikes. I mean, where you know it's almost indicative of, it jumps at you that there's some policy intervention that is driving it. I mean, in at different points. And I just read a little quote. In the late 90s and early 2000s, these countries raised public spending, trying to offset exogenous shocks to growth. Now, the problem with this is that it is predicted to fail, right? Because, and this comes straight out of the Dimas framework, although I'm quoting someone else, policymakers control over macroeconomic targets, variables such as output, is inversely proportional to the degree of openness. So output in small states is ultimately determined by their productive capacities rather than demand management policies. So what has been the result? I mean, the result is, of course, mounting public sector debt, worsening external balance, trade balance, anemic growth, and a dubious impact on employment. So for the next few slides, I'm going to focus on the makings of what probably might be a way forward for us here. And I'd start by stating explicitly my view. Small states are always going to be of necessity exporters of goods and commodities, goods and services, for which they have comparative advantage based on either their highly constrained natural resource base and or the skill and ingenuity of the limited in size labor force. So this suggests, that in small states, growth is hinged on how fast, right, or how much and how fast skill and ingenuity is developed. And I think this is almost a quote from, or if it's not a quote, it's certainly well within the flavor of what Dimas was saying. So two things readily jump at you. One, you should try to keep your labor force healthy and economically productive for longer, and that would help, all right? Because presumably longer somebody lives, the more their gray matter develops and so on, and they're able to bring various experiences to problems and come up with innovative solutions. And then we should increase the quality of labor through education. So I just pulled some figures on health. And what I'm doing here, I'm using, as a proxy for health, I'm using life expectancy at birth, right? Average life expectancy at birth. So I have some Latin, OECS countries, and I'm comparing it to Latin America. And, I mean, you could clearly see that number of the OECS countries had a sort of head start on the Latin American counterparts, but by 25 years later, Latin American countries are ahead of them in terms of life expectancy. The change in between those two periods, the average change in the OECS is 3.5 years, as opposed to almost 6 years in Latin America. Just to show the dynamic, I use St. Lucia and St. Vincent. St. Vincent was the country at the bottom of the pile for the OECS, and St. Lucia was sort of average. And I'm comparing it to Ecuador and Peru, which were like the star performers in Latin America. And I think that gives us a good idea as to, you know, the extent to which we have fallen behind and as well as it presents an opportunity for us in terms of work that needs to be done and could be done. Education, I just focus on two areas. Pre-primary education, you see again that we are a bit behind in Latin America. And in tertiary education, you see the gap again is opening up. I've been advised that I have 1 minute left, I think. That's one, right? Yeah. 40 seconds, right. So I have some other slides, but I'm not going to go through it because I want to be fair to my other speakers, and I just say thank you for the opportunity.